Ich kann auch, das sagen jetzt Section, Four-Point Three und Second Dachteil, Prickle, Transition. Der duktil spröde Übergang. Okay. And for Buckenschenkel cubic metals or also hexagonal metals, we have a so-called transition region. When we plot, for example, the energy spent to in the Charpy impact test, im Kerbschlagversuch, when I plot that against the temperature, we have an upper shelf region, eine Hochlage, where the high energy is required to separate that specimen. And at low temperatures, we have a lower shelf region, eine Tieflage. And in between, we have that transition region. So here is the energy plotted against the temperature, and that curve shows the percent of brittle fracture against the temperature. Here we have zero brittle fracture in the upper shelf region, and here we have 100% brittle fracture in the lower shelf region. In fact, it's the usual result of Chappie experiments. You can do the same when you make fracture mechanics experiments. And in that diagram, you see the results of fracture experiments where specimens with different sizes have been used. The larger specimens were 4T. Specimens, the specimen type was compact tension, CT specimens. And 4T means that the specimen thickness was 4 times 1 inch, that means roughly 100 millimeter thickness. They got full squares here. Here we have specimens that are 3 inch thick. And we have specimens with a thickness of 1 and 1/2 inch, also 12.5 millimeters thickness. And you have valid J1C values only for the very thick specimens in the upper shelf region. In the for the thinner specimens, the K1C values are not valid, but the J-integral, critical J-integral, has been determined, and therefore we plot here the KJC values, okay? The KJ values. The stress intensity values calculated from known values of the J-integral. And you see also here upper shelf region, the lower shelf region, and the transition region. And the small diagram here is the amount of stable crack growth in the specimen. Stable crack growth means microductal fracture. You know already that in the upper shelf region we have microductal fracture, in the lower shelf region for the BCC metals we have cleavage fracture, and in the transition region we have both. We have partly microductal fracture and partly cleavage fracture. Okay, now the experimental findings can be plotted in form of what I call schemes. And the first scheme is that, just that I plot Kj against the temperature, and I have the upper shelf, the lower shelf region, and sometimes you can separate the lower shelf region into two regions, one where the where you have fracture, cleavage fracture, just extra yield stress of the material, and here in fact part you have cleavage fracture at a higher stress than the yield stress. Here too, for region two, you have we have that transition region. And here we have that you see that the amount of microductal fracture increases when you come more and more to a higher temperature nearer to the upper shelf region. what you see here also, here is now plotted Kj versus the specimen size. Here are the thicker specimen, 4T specimen, 2T specimen, 1T, and 0.5T. And what you see immediately is that the scatter of the Kj values is highest for the thinnest specimens, and we have a low scatter when you have thick specimens, and we have something like a lower limit value, lower limit Kj value. Okay. And that is schematically in scheme two, plotted in that way. You have an increase of the scatter band when you go from a high specimen size to a low specimen size, a high specimen thickness to a low specimen thickness. And that result that a small specimen shows a higher scatter results in the fact that when you plot the mean values of the Kj values, that transition temperature seems to be lower for the thinner specimens than for the thicker specimens. For the large specimens, let's assume we have no scatter, then the mean value lies on that full curve here. And for that is the scatter for the thin specimens. And when you plot the mean values, mean Kj values against the temperature, you you get the result that the transition region is shifted to a lower temperature. Okay, and scheme three is also the fact that the scatter is especially high in the transition region. We have a low scatter as well as in the lower shelf region, as well as in the upper shelf region. Okay, that were the experimental findings, and now we come to the explanation of that experimental findings with a model. In fact, model is called weakest link model. You know, a chain breaks at its weakest links, and a Kette bricht an ihrem schwächsten Glied. And that is, here we have plotted one of the thick specimens, that is like the 4T specimens in the experiments shown. And we separate the specimens in slices, and each of the slices is half an inch thick. Yeah. And for every slice, we determine the critical defect. And that is that defect that causes cleavage fracture. Yeah, and in every slice we have only one critical defect. There might be other defects present, but that defect plotted here is the critical defect that causes the fracture of the slice. Yeah. And now we determine for every slice, we determine now the fracture toughness when that critical defect starts to grow. And to do that, we apply the Griffith criterion, and we do it in the way we have seen on, in Chen's model. Here, yeah. That is the Griffith criterion. Yeah. Sigma must be larger than the square root of, that is the specific energy required for failure, that is the Young's modulus, and that is the defect size. Yeah? And we have, and here is the location of such a critical defect. It is a distance R star in front of the crack tip, of the initial crack tip. And it has a size R star. And from that value, if I insert that value here into the Griffith criterion, then I can determine the stress intensity when the defect begins to grow. And you see that stress intensity is proportional to the square root of the ratio between the distance R star and the defect size. Okay? And that criterion now we apply for every defect in each slice, for every critical defect in each slice. And so we can determine now for every slice that critical k value when the defect starts to grow. Okay? And that is what we get. For example, let's see, here we have a large defect in the center of the specimen, rather small distance between defect and crack front, and so we will have the lowest fracture toughness, the lowest K value for slice 5. Okay? And then I have assumed that for slice 2, I have the second lowest K value for slice 1, for example, we have a rather small defect near the side surface of the specimen, and so that K value will be quite high, and therefore with the highest K value there. Yeah. Okay, now let's assume we have one key specimen, when we have, and that resembles that scatter of that result here, for the thin specimens here, yeah, you see? And now let's assume we have one key specimen, and then for that slice, either defect 1 or defect 2 is critical. And since Kj of slice 2 is lower than that of 1, slice 2 will determine the fracture of that specimen. When we consider 3 and 4, we have again to take the lowest value between 3 and 4, and it's the 3 value. And for 5 and 6, of course, 5 is the lowest value. And for 7 and 8, 7 is the lowest value. And so we have a decreased scatter when we have now one key specimen. Okay? And so you can repeat that now, when the specimen is 2 inches thick, for example, then for that half of the specimen, again, slice 5, that defect 5 is the critical defect, and for that piece of material, defect 2 is the critical defect, and of course for the whole specimen, defect 5 is the critical one. Yeah? And you see that the weakest link model can very well describe the experimental findings that we have here. Okay. You can also explain with that model all that schemes that we have shown here. You can also, that is now explained, it is clear. Yeah. Okay.